during the last set of the CBSE NET paper. So this set includes most of the questions from Research Aptitude. We'll be trying to solve these questions, and also along with this question there are few questions that were based on mental ability that we would be doing in this class. Now the first question is based on Venn diagram. Rather than being a numerical on Venn diagram, this is a theoretical question that has been asked for the first time in based on Venn diagram. Now this question, it's very important to, before we start this question, we must be aware of categorical arguments. Now categorical arguments are something when we try to classify. For example, I say all intelligent men are rational and all rational beings are good. So all intelligent beings should be good is a kind of categorical argument. And when we try to place a categorical argument, we try to test the validity of that categorical argument. And this validity is tested by means of Venn diagram. So with Venn diagram, we can test the validity of an argument and we can say whether this categorical argument or categorical syllogism is valid or invalid. We'll be covering this categorical syllogism in a separate class where we will be talking about this in more details and its relation to Venn diagrams. Okay. So as I mentioned, it tests the validity. So C option would be correct here. Okay. Venn diagram, let me draw a simple Venn diagram here. So this is students who are passing in English, students who are passing in mathematics. So there are 20 students who pass in English and 30 students who pass in mathematics, and there are 8 students who pass both in English and mathematics. So that's the overlapping region. So it's something I'm clearly denoting on the diagram. So if I write 28 and 30, I say 20 people who are passing only English. So 20 plus 8 would be the total number of candidates who would pass in English. 30 people are passing only in mathematics, and 30 plus 8 would be the total number of students who are passing in mathematics. And there are 8 students who are passing in both English and mathematics. Okay, so this is something that I am clearly denoting. So it's a clear method of notation. And what I am doing is, I am representing it graphically by means of diagram. So this is again correct. So I can say A is correct, C is correct and D is correct. Venn diagram can enhance our understanding. I cannot say it is enhancing my understanding, but I can say it is representing graphically what is given. So if I mention 4 statements, rather than mentioning those 4 statements, I can just draw this diagram and depict it graphically. So I am depicting it graphically with a clear notation, but it is not improving my understanding. Okay. So this is the only choice that is not applicable here. So you have A, C and D as the correct option. So the answer would be A, C and D here. The next question is a question based on assertion and reason. Now in this question, let's talk about the first statement. Formal communication tends to be fast and flexible. This is a kind of incorrect statement, because the communication that is considered fast and flexible is a communication that is spreads through word of mouth, and word of mouth communication is usually known as informal or grapevine communication. So it's informal communication that tends to be much more fast and flexible. So A is incorrect. Okay. Among all these, the only choice where A is incorrect is B. So the answer should be definitely 2. But let me read the second statement again. Formal communication is systematic and orderly flow of information. That's correct, because if you have a news coming in a newspaper or a TV channel, you will have a systematic flow of the information that is being given. So that is correct. So the answer would be assertion is false and reason is correct. The next question. When the purpose of the definition is to explain or to determine ambiguity, the definition is known as. Now we would be taking a separate session on the types of definition where we would be talking about these in detail. Here I will be giving you just a brief idea. Lexical means explaining the present use. So if I say presently something is ambiguous means uncertain. Okay. So if I say something is uncertain now, then I can say this definition is lexical. So the current use or the current application would fall under lexical. Persuasive, when I am trying to have some emotive concepts attached to it, so I can have a kind of positive feeling for something or negative feeling for something. Stipulative is, I am trying to give totally new meaning to a new term. So the term is new and the meaning is new. That is what is stipulative. And theoretical. Theoretically, you try to explain the use and you also determine the ambiguity. So the correct answer here would be theoretical definitions, where you are trying to explain the real use. For example, if I say mass, okay, I am explaining the meaning of word mass. I am explaining mass in relation to Newton's laws, okay. So what I am trying to do is, I am trying to explain that concept, I am trying to explain its applicability to the concept, and then I might try to generalize it or I might try to extend it further. Okay, so that is what is a theoretical definition. Now, inductive reasoning is grounded on, you said that inductive reasoning is grounded on the concept of uniformity of nature. Now, let's understand how. I can say this can be true in two forms. If I try to generalize something or if I try to presuppose something from past to future. For example, if I say Newton's law of gravitation is true. Okay? It is true for a small object. If I put this pen, it would go. If I leave this pen, it will go down. It is true for bigger objects like Earth. Earth is attracted by the gravitational force of the sun. Okay. So this uniformity of nature applies to small object, applies to bigger object. It applies across time. This concept that gravitation holds true is falling is currently true. If I bring this concept after 10 years or 20 years, again it would be true. Okay, so it presumes from past to future and it withholds its truth or its validity for the next point of time. And generalize basically means, for example, a kid goes to a zoo and sees swans which are white in color. The first statement that the kid would say, all swans are white in color. Now, this can be my generalization unless and until I have seen swans that are black in color or pink in color. Okay, so I generalize the things based on my knowledge, and that is what is inductive reasoning talks about. So it talks about generalizing and presupposing what we already know. So the correct answer here would be choice A, that is in uniformity of nature. Now, next question is a question based on the problem of direction. Now, it's really an interesting question and much easier questions on directions that were previously asked in the past papers. So let's say this is Prakash. So I'll first mark out the directions, north, south, east and west. So here is Prakash. He walked 10 kilometers towards south. So he goes 10 kilometers. Then when he is south, he turns right. So he will go in this direction. Okay. So he goes in this direction, 5 kilometers. Okay, once he is here, he turns right. So right would be towards the upside again, this way, and walk 10 kilometers. He again walks 10 kilometers. Now from this point, when he is here, he goes left, that's this side, and walks 10 kilometers. How many kilometers will have to walk to reach home straight? So he'll have to walk this 10 kilometer. So this is where Prakash was standing. So this 10 kilometer plus this section of 5 kilometers. So the answer would be 10 plus 5 in a straight line. So that's 15 kilometers. So the correct answer is A, 15 kilometers. Now next question is a question based on series completion. Now looking at the series, there can be numerous ways in which students can think, you can try to solve it. So you can say there is a difference of 3, 4, 10 and so on. Then you try to take subsequent differences, you try to see whether it's a square or a cube or something. But I have a very simple idea here. If I multiply 2 by 2, that's 4, and add 1, I get 5. If I multiply 5 by 2, that's 10, and subtract 1, I get 9. So in one, what I'm doing is multiplying by 2 and adding 1. In the next, I'm multiplying by 2 and subtracting 1. So in the next, what I will do is multiply by 2 and add 1. So the next number is, you have 9 here. So 9 into 2 plus 1. So that's 18 plus 1, 19. You have 19 into 2 minus 1. So 19 into 2 is 38. 38 minus 1 is 37. You have 37 into 2 plus 1. So you have 74. 74 plus 1, that would be equal to 75. So the correct answer here would be 75. This was again a very simple question based on mental ability. The next question is a very, very tricky question where most of the students got caught up in this examination. Now, in this question, what is given is, in an examination, 10,000 students appeared. The results revealed the following data. Okay? Students who passed in all the 5 subjects, students who passed in 3 subjects, passed in only 1 subject, passed in only 2 subjects, who failed in English only, who failed in chemistry only, who failed in biosciences only, who failed in physics only, and who failed in mathematics only. Now in all these choices, the word only is important. Now if this would have been rather than 5 subjects, it was just 2 subjects, I could have easily drawn a Venn diagram and explained you. Since it has become 5 subjects, even if I draw a Venn diagram, it would make things confusing. So let me just keep that aside in my mind and go straight on to the question, that is, the number of students passed in at least 4 subjects. Okay? So the data of who passed in only 2 subjects are given, so that is redundant, I don't need that. Students who passed only in 1 subject is again redundant, I don't need that. Students who passed only in 3 subjects is again redundant, I don't need that. I need people who passed at least in 4 subjects. So this data is useful, the people passing in 5 subjects, that is 5, 5, 8, 3, that's useful. Now, people who failed, students who failed only in English are 75, that means there are 5 subjects, okay, and there are 75 students who failed in English only, that means in the remaining 4 subjects they passed. So I would add this 75. Similarly, they are failing only in chemistry, so they are passing in the remaining subjects. So I'll add 140. These are failing only in biosciences and passing in other subjects. So I'll add 157. These are failing only in physics and passing in the remaining 4 subjects. So I'll add 145. And these are failing only in mathematics and passing in the remaining subjects. So I'll add 200. Now if I total these out, this comes to be 6300. So the correct answer here would be 6300. So this question was the question where most of the students got caught up, but rather than being the question looking very big and very complicated, this is some of the question that is based on a basic fundamental approach. Since it's asking students who are passing in at least 4 subjects, students who are passing in only 2 subjects, only 1 subject and only 3 subjects would be ignored and the remaining students would be summed up. Now the next question, which one of the following is not a principle of effective communication? So when I talk about effective communication, it's very important that I understand the exact meaning of what is being said here. So effective communication here, I am trying to use convincing dialogues, that's one of the correct statements. I am trying to if the audience are participating, that means the communication is definitely effective because there is communication between the speaker and the audience. Okay, so 3 is correct, 4 is correct. Now among these two, since here it is given a strategic use of grapevine communication, it means this grapevine communication here is effective. If I would have just mentioned grapevine communication, that could have included rumors or other ideas. Okay, so that won't be that effective. But since I am saying strategic use of grapevine, that means if there is an information about layoffs in the company, how can a manager take feedback from the employees or put it in front of a group of employees or strategically devise techniques to communicate with the employees. So therefore, 2 is correct. One-way transfer of information is a transfer of information. I cannot say whether it would be very effective or not. So a newspaper, you have thousands of news coming in. You don't know out of those thousands of news, which of the following news would be capturing your attention much more as compared to other news. So it is a kind of communication, but it's hard to say whether it's an effective communication or not. So these 3 are definitely effective communication. Now the next question is a question based on the problem of blood relation. Now consider 2 people here, me and a boy. Okay, so the girl introduced a boy as the son of the daughter of the father of her uncle. Okay, if we read it this way, it becomes much more confusing. So let me start it from the back. Okay, so her uncle. So here is the girl. Here is the uncle. Father of the uncle. So uncle's father would be my uncle, and my father of my uncle would be kind of grandfather for me. Daughter of the father. So this father's daughter. So I can say this uncle and this daughter can be brothers and sisters. Okay. Now the son of the daughter. So daughter's son. Since this, he is an uncle to me. Okay. So the girl would be at this level. So I am increasing the hierarchy. This would be at the level of grandfather. This would be at a level of parents, father or mother. And this would be the level of child. So that is a kind of hierarchy that I am mentioning. So now you want to say the boy is related to girl as. So boy would be related to girl as brother. Okay. I'll repeat this again. So girl's uncle, uncle's father. So father's daughter would be related to this uncle. So they can be brothers or sisters. Okay. Or husband or wife. Brothers or sisters, okay. And then the son of this daughter would be definitely my brother, my cousin. So the answer would be son. The next question is a problem based on coding and decoding. Now coding decoding problems, the best way to solve these is to write the letters A to Z in a circular form. So I have A, B, C. Now I'll see the location of the letters that are being placed. Okay, so you have M that is being replaced by I. So you have M replaced by I. I jump 3 letters back. A replaced by X. I jump 2 letters back. P replaced by Q. I jump 2 letters back. And what would be hotels? So for hotels, I jump 2 letters back, H E. Okay. Then I jump O. O again, I jump 2 letters back, that would be L. Then T, I jump 2 letters back. So that would be Q. So the closest match here is ELQ. Okay. The next question is the question based on communication. The languages. So communication. This question is a kind of question that is being asked as vague. And again this question, there is a kind of discrepancy that has come up here. So since M moves to I, I am trying to leave three letters and move one back. Okay. So with H, if I try to leave three letters and move one back, the answer should start with D. Okay. And the next letter would be 2 back. So since A becomes X, I am leaving 2 letters. So O would be leaving 2 letters. So the next letter should be K. But somehow something has been done in this question that the first letter you are leaving 2 letters and then the next question you are leaving 3 letters. Okay. And that's the nearest choice that comes up among all. Okay. So the answer here would definitely be 4. But however, there is vagueness in this question, and similarly there is vagueness again in this question where you are trying to say in communication languages. Now since there is no specific way of communication that has been mentioned, it is very hard to predict the correct answer here. So communication can be of two types. It can be oral or written. Now oral communication is spoken, and when you are speaking you are using vocabulary or verbal language. So if I say oral, I can definitely say it's a kind of verbal. But if it is a kind of written communication, it's not verbal, you are not speaking, so it is non-verbal. But in either case, language is symbolic. I can use various kinds of symbols. For example, if I use A to Z, these are symbols. I have assigned some meaning to these symbols. If I want to explain you something about book, I can just draw a picture of book and I can say this is a book. I can just draw a picture of table and I can say this is a table. That is again a way of depicting something, so that's symbolic. So language, be it in any form, is definitely symbolic. Okay. How you use the language, it can be verbal or non-verbal. Interpersonal has no relationship in this question. So in either case, 4 cannot be the choice. So the closest match with what we can say in this question is first, that is symbolic code. However, you can there can be also a probability of verbal being correct. Since there is nothing mentioned in the question, you cannot exactly say what the examiner wants out of it. The next question is a question related on problems of age solving. Now this is again a bit tricky question because here 3 persons are being involved. So sometimes the students get caught up with why 3 persons are involved. We know to solve age problems only with 2 people. Okay. So let's do this question in a simple fashion by reading one statement and solving that statement. At present, a person is 4 times older than his son. Okay. 4 times older than his son. So here is the person, here is the son. So let the son be X. The person is 4 times older than the son. Okay. Now here is the person and here is the wife. The person is 3 years older than his wife. So let the wife's age be Y. So the person's age is 3 years older than wife's age. After 3 years, the age of the son will be 15. So now, I put this in this first section. After 3 years, the son's age would be 15 years. So presently, the son's age would be 15 minus 3, that's 12 years. Since the present age of the son is 12 years, I can say the father's age would be 4 into 12. So that's 48 years. Okay. The next statement. Since the father's age is 48, I put 48 here. And this person is 3 years older to his wife. So wife's age would be 3 years less than the husband's age. So since this is 48, I can say this would be 48 minus 3. So the wife's age would be 45 years. The question asks the age of the person's wife after 5 years will be. Now this is the present age of the wife. So the present age of the wife is 45. After 5 years it would be 45 plus 5. So the answer would be 50 years. So the correct answer here would be 50. I will repeat the solution again since a lot of students got stuck up with this question. At present, a person is 4 times older than his son. Okay, so let the son's age be x, the person's age would be 4x. This person is 3 years older than his wife. So consider the wife's age is y. So the person's age would be 3 years more than the wife's age. So it would be y plus 3. Now after 3 years, the age of the son would be 15 years. So since after 3 years, the age of the son would be 15 years, presently he is 3 years less than what would he be after 3 years. So 15 minus 3 would give you the present age of the son. So that would be 12 years. So I have 12 years here. Now since son is 12 years, father is 4 times his age. So father's age would be 48 years. And father is 3 years older to his wife. That means wife is 3 years smaller or 3 years younger. So wife's age would be 48 minus 3, that's 45 years. That would be the present age of the wife. And the question asks you about the age of the wife after 5 years. This is also important to know, because most of the question students, they just did it till here and marked the answer as 45. That shows the present age, and you are asked the age after 5 years. So that would be 45 plus 5. So the correct answer here would be 50 years. So with this we finish the complete paper on CBSE NET June 2015 paper 1. We would be continuously solving the papers for the further examination that come up. You can subscribe to ExamBase channel for all further updates on paper 1 and CBSE NET. Till then, have a good day.